JFT, just fair and direct.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to JFD's Daily Market Review for June the 17th. I am Charalambos Pissouros, Senior Market Analyst here at JFD, and I will talk about yesterday's main market movers, what's my opinion moving ahead, what are today's important events, and how they could affect the markets. But before we start, let's read our disclaimer. The content we produce does not constitute investment advice or investment recommendation, should not be considered as such, and does not in any way constitute an invitation to acquire any financial instrument or product. I will leave you a few seconds to read the rest, and then we will jump into our analysis. Okay, the dollar rebounded yesterday, and today it was found higher against most of the other G10 currencies. It gained the most versus SEK, Aussie, and NOK in that order, while it decked out the least gains versus the Canadian dollar and the Swiss franc. The greenback underperformed only against the yen. Now, the strengthening of the yen, the dollar and the franc, combined with the weakening of the Aussie and the Kiwi, suggests that risk appetite deteriorated again at some point yesterday. Looking at the performance in the equity world, we see that major EU and US indices traded in green territory, with investors perhaps adding to their risk exposure after the Fed announced it will start purchasing corporate bonds. What may have boosted sentiment even further may have been a report saying that the Trump administration is preparing a nearly $1 trillion US dollars infrastructure proposal, while market chatter suggested that US firms may be allowed to work with China's Huawei on new 5G standards, which may have eased trade tensions between the world's two largest economies. The fact that US retail sales jumped by a record of 17.7% in May could have also been a positive. However, the broader optimism softened during the Asian session today, perhaps due to a fresh acceleration in infected cases around the globe from the coronavirus, with China ramping up restrictions on people leaving Beijing. Adding to the skepticism was Fed Chair Powell's remarks before the Senate Banking Committee. He said that output and employment will remain well below their pre-COVID levels for a long time, adding that there is a reasonable probability that more policy support would be needed. Geopolitical tensions also weighed on sentiment, with India reporting that 20 soldiers had been killed in clashes with Chinese troops, while North Korea vowed to send back military forces to its border with South Korea after it blew up a joint liaison office set up to foster better ties between the two nations. Now, as for our view, still it has not changed. Geopolitical tensions usually do not last forever. While most governments around the globe continue to ease their lockdown measures, something that keeps hopes over a potential economic recovery alive. What's more, although Fed Chair Powell appeared somewhat pessimistic over the US economic outlook, still data points that the economy is performing better than many may have anticipated. So with encouraging headlines with regards to virus treatments also hitting the wires, we see decent chances for equities and other risk-linked assets to rebound again, and for the safe havens to pull back. As we noted yesterday, we will reconsider that view if more governments around the globe start reimposing stay-at-home restrictive measures. As for today, during the early European morning, we already got the UK CPIs for May. The headline CPI slowed to 0.5% year-over-year from 0.8%, while the core rate slid to 1.2% year-over-year from 1.4%, missing estimates of 1.3%. In our view, slowing inflation, further below the Bank of England's objective of 2%, may increase speculation that tomorrow Bank of England policymakers will discuss the option of negative interest rates, something that could prove negative for the pound. Now, later in the day, we get more inflation data for May, this time from Canada. The headline rate is expected to have ticked up, but to have stayed within the negative territory. Specifically, it is expected to have risen to -0.1% year over year from -0.2%, while no forecast is currently available for the core rate. At the prior Bank of Canada gathering, policymakers kept interest rates unchanged and said that given the improvement in short-term funding conditions, the bank reduced the frequency of its term repo operations and its program to purchase bankers' acceptances. They also said that the Canadian economy appears to have avoided the most severe scenario presented in the bank's April monetary policy report and that the economy is expected to resume growth in the third quarter. With inflation also near the bank's estimates, all this suggests that as long as coronavirus-related restrictions are lifted and as long as data continues to suggest that the worst is behind us, Canadian policymakers are likely to refrain from expanding their stimulus efforts anytime soon. As for the rest of today's events, apart from the UK and Canadian inflation data, we also get Eurozone's final CPIs for May, but as it is always the case, they are expected to confirm their preliminary estimates. We also get the US building permits and housing starts, both for May. With regards to the energy market, we have the Energy Information Administration weekly report on crude oil inventories, and the forecast points to a 0.152 million barrels decline, after a 5.720 million increase. However, bearing in mind that yesterday the American Petroleum Institute report revealed a 3.900 million inventory build, we would consider the risks surrounding the Energy Information Administration forecast as tilted to the upside. Tonight, during the Asian morning Thursday, New Zealand's GDP for the first quarter and Australia's employment report for May are coming out. New Zealand's GDP is expected to have contracted 0.9% quarter over quarter after expanding 0.5% in the last 3 months of 2019, something that will drag the year over year rate down to 0.3% from 1.8%. Australia's unemployment rate is expected to have risen to 7% in May from 6.2%, while the net change in employment is forecast to show that the economy has lost 125,000 jobs after losing 594,300 in April. As for the speakers, Fed Chair Jerome Powell will present his testimony before the House Financial Services Committee, while we will also get to hear from ECB Vice President Luis de Guindos, ECB Executive Board Member Yves Mersch, and Cleveland Fed President Loretta Mester. So that's it from me. Thank you very much for watching and listening. For those who are interested in learning about the main events of the week much earlier, you can subscribe to the weekly Market Outlook webinar, which I'm holding every Monday at 7 o'clock AM GMT time. You can find the link in the description below. So goodbye, have a great day, and I'm looking forward to seeing you here again tomorrow.
JFT, just fair and direct.